son I might have known. If God had granted me a son, the summers die one by one. How soon they fly on and on. And I am old and will be gone. Bring him
I want to thank you all for coming tonight, or today, to this celebration of life of the memory of Michael Clark. By Mike's request, there was no wake, there was no funeral, there was just this. And he went around talking to people, asking them to speak at this event. I was specifically asked, you know, if I could hold it together long enough to get through it. You know, Mike was pretty sure I'd mess it up. He'd be happy to see the people that are here today. These were the people that cared about him and that he cared about. And we're going to have some reflections from some different individuals with regards to their experiences with him. For me, it'll be the time that I met him back in 1982, and coming forward from there. Now, we would ask that if you have a cell phone, turn it off, put it on silent, whatever, so that it doesn't go off during the service. It was appropriate that Mike had something from Les Miserables. You know, when I hear that, or I'm Les Miserables is brought to mind, it brings me that quote at the end of the play, to love another person is to see the face of God. And knowing Mike, having spent time with him, I felt blessed, and I felt that love. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Mike Puglise to come up and give a reading. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'd like to begin reading from Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 10. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Thank you, Lisa, for allowing me the privilege and honor to speak on behalf of your husband, my friend, Mike Clark. Now, Mike Clark gave me two directives, and they're pretty stiff directives. Don't know if I can complete them. And I really need your help, and you'll understand why. The first one, this was to be a joyful occasion. He did not want any of us grieving. He wanted this to be truly a celebration of his life, like Joe explained to us. Mike loved his colleagues. He loved his community. Most of all, he loved his family. Now, the second directive is the most difficult, because Mike told me that if I did not accomplish number one, and you guys don't have a good time, that he would be watching me from up there, and when I got up there, there would be things to be reckoned with. I won't fill in the things. Now imagine this, I always thought my journey in life was really just going to be dealing with St. Peter, clearing the gates, maybe encounter the choir of angels at some point, and then I'm home free. Now if I don't pull this off, now I got Judge Michael Clark telling me, come over here, that door ain't going to open yet, and there's no redo. But putting all kidding aside, grief is a difficult task. It is so hard to tell our loved ones and our friends, don't grieve. We're going to do it. And one scripture that Mike and I bannered around was the story of Lazarus. And we all know the story of Lazarus. Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. But the part of the story that intrigued us the most is the beginning of the story, where it explains that Jesus openly wept. He cried about the loss of his friend Lazarus. Why did he cry? That was always so confusing, and Mike and I talked about it. He could most certainly raise Lazarus from the dead. But why did he cry? Well, Lazarus was his friend. He played with Lazarus. He worked with Lazarus. He grew up with Lazarus. And he's explaining to us that it's okay to grieve. He understands that. But then Christ takes it a step further, and he gives us hope. There's the resurrection. We will see our friend Mike again. And Mike understood that. And let me tell you about something about Mike when I sat with him in his last days. The courage this man showed, the remarkable strength and spirituality I have never seen before. And he left me with one thing, and this is the words that I got to get across to you that I'm going to have to face him with. He said, Mike, he said, God lives in your heart. It's that simple. We know that Mike was well read, and he said that all in his readings, seeking God, finding God, is as simple as God is in your heart. And once we accomplish that, then we will see God in each other. And we'll go a step further. We'll see God in all things. And that's what I leave you with. I was fortunate enough to spend the last days with my friend Mike, and he left that with me to pass on. And I hope I did, because I truly believe that Mike is telling us that. Once we accomplish that, then this thing called life is so easy. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. I'm going to start today by reading Revelations. It was a verse that Mike and Lisa picked out for me to read. And it's Revelations 21, verse 4. And God shall wipe away all the tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. I'm honored to stand here before you all today. I'm honored that Mike and Lisa would ask me to speak on Mike's behalf. You see, Mike was my friend, he was my mentor, and he was family to me. He'll always be Judge Clark to me. I never once called him Mike. I always called him Judge Clark, and that was out of respect. Once you earn that title, you have it for life. See, Judge Clark was a man amongst men, and his life was devoted to others and helping others. He was not a selfish man. You see, when he stepped aside from the bench, when he retired, he could have chose numerous things to do, but he chose to give a small firm in his hometown a chance. He chose my firm. He chose Oxendine and Sauls. You see, Judge Clark was never someone who picked the easy way. Of course he could have went and he could have got the $200,000-$300,000 salary. No, he paved his own way. He went against the grain. That made his victories even better. So it made it larger than life to him. I appreciate so much that he lent me his reputation. And we had clients and I would say, hey, this is Judge Clark. How about let me introduce you to him? And you know those clients, they just love to be introduced to Judge Clark. You know, in the back of my mind, I enjoyed introducing them to Judge Clark. You see, he gave instant credibility to whatever he touched. He owned a courtroom when he walked in it. He owned any room when he walked in it. He had charisma, and that's something that you don't just learn. You either have it or you don't. You know, I always welcomed his help, no matter what it was. And he had that swagger about him. Everyone in this audience understands that swagger that Mike had. And when you walked in with him, it was never behind him. It was always, Trey, come on up here beside me. And when we walked in, I had that swagger myself. It makes you have that confidence. And you all know what I'm talking about. You bow out your chest just a little bit more than you ever would before. And you already think you won it before you even started. So you see, I've been with Mike, and I've been before him when he was a judge, and I've been in court with him whenever he was an attorney. And it didn't matter what side the aisle he was on or which side the bench he was on. He would take a 2-week trial and turn it into about a 10-minute trial because none of the fluff mattered. And you all laugh because you understand that's just what he did. He loved Lisa to death. She made him go outside of the box. She made him do things that he wasn't secure doing, but he would do them with a smile on his face. I never heard a bad word about her, but I did hear some grumbles whenever we were sitting in our office eating cheeseburgers and he had to get his Lean Cuisine meal and eat it. And I said, Mike, you sure you don't want any French fries, man? They're really good. No, I better not. I think Lisa may have smelled him on his breath if he went home. Katie, he was proud of you. You were his bulldog. I think he was proud the day that you opened up your photography studio, and he said great things about you. Tara, you were the best court reporter that ever walked the face of the earth. Ryan, I mean, the best IT guy ever. I don't know whether everyone knows it, but we had some ransomware and some Bitcoin stuff, and I couldn't even tell you what it was. But he said, you just call Ryan, he'll figure it out, and we'll get it done. And Ryan came in, and he figured it out, and he got it done for us, and we were able to get all our information back. Joe, he loved you like a brother, and he would tell me that the best actor in the world was you. And I believe him. I believe him. I've been in that courtroom with you. And he would smile every time he would tell a story about you. So you see, Mike always helped people. He didn't have to. He wanted to. He always seen the best in people. Whether he was a judge and presiding over whatever awful case it was, he always thought that this person deserves another chance. You see, he was a man of integrity. The first time I ever had a case in front of Judge Clark, what he did is he called the opposing counsel and myself into his chambers, and he said, you know, I know these people, and I had a case where their parents were the victims, and he said, you know, if y'all think it necessary, we will recuse. I'll recuse myself from this case. And you know, opposing counsel and I, we looked at each other and we kind of said, you know, any judge that would bring that to your attention doesn't need to be recused. I'm going to miss my friend. I'm going to miss my mentor. And promised I wasn't going to get upset, but how can I help it? And I never told Judge Clark bye. And it's not bye for me, because I will see him again. He taught me so much. And these individuals who are speaking knew him way longer than I did, but he had such an impact on my life in the short time that I was able to be around him. And I'm just honored that he chose me to get up here and speak to you all. I want to close by reading a baseballism. It's a poem, and it's entitled One, and I think it fit Mike well. One, you've got one life, you've got one glove, you've got one game, you've got one love, you've got one chance, you're just one man. So play this game as hard as you can. I'm glad that my friend is at peace, and Godspeed, Mike Clark.
Good afternoon. Mike was sometimes my judge, but he was always my friend. I was fortunate to work with Mike as a receiver and a special master on many projects. These quasi-judicial projects allowed me to work one-on-one with Mike and fostered a unique working relationship. We recognize those who help us in life, but we should be especially thankful for those who push us to grow and learn. Those people who push us to be more than we believe we are, and those people who push us to accomplish more than we think we are capable of. Mike was that guy in my life. Mike had the ability to see what a person was capable of and would grow frustrated when he saw someone who was not approaching the limits of their ability. Many times he would call me to court on a crazy, out-of-control civil case, introduce me, and then walk off the bench, leaving me there, leaving me to make sense out of some impossible situation. He would then wait back in his office for me, and with a big smile, he'd say, "Fix this up as soon as you can." In my case, Mike could see my finish line was miles ahead of where I thought it was. Most of us choose to take a most direct and well-traveled path in life. Mike liked to take me down the back roads. He seemed to know that it was in getting temporarily lost that we learn the most about ourselves and the law. He was often my GPS from hell, but I was sure the wiser for the paths he sent me on. Mike knew that a good lawyer was one that was not afraid to try new things, even if it meant sometimes getting lost. I, for one, am, in large part, who I am because of Mike's pushing me and sending me down the less traveled roads. There are probably many in this room that can say the same thing. Mike knew that humor was a wonderful tool that could be used to soften any difficult situation. As I sat with Mike in his hospital room after learning that he was about to go into hospice, it was a very sad time. Mike sat on the bed with his eyes closed. He was in obvious pain. I wanted to say something, but at those times you don't know what to say. Finally, I thought of something to say, and I said, I spoke to Mike Puglise, and he's praying for you. He opened his eyes and said, it would be nice to see Mike. I said, do you want me to make it happen? He nodded yes. I walked out of the room with my hands shaking, hoping that I could get Mike Puglise. Mike answered the phone, and he said, Joe, I'll be there. I'm on my way. I went back into Mike's room and told him that Mike was on the way, and he nodded. After a few moments, he smiled and said something that I didn't understand. I said, Mike, what did you say? He said, if I wasn't so sick, I'd mess with Mike Puglise. I said, my friend, one is never too sick to mess with somebody. He became more and more like his old self and started naming the things that we could do to Mike. Some of these ideas were even unsettling to me. I'm figuring, we just want to scare the guy. We don't want to send him into counseling. Finally, we came up with a plan to get poor, unsuspecting Mike Puglise. Mike called and said, Joe, I'm on my way upstairs. So I went out in the hallway. Mike came down the hall and I met him and I said, Mike, it's not good. I said, he doesn't have much time. He's put together a list of stuff he wants to get done. He's asked me to help him with the list. I told him I would. And I'm gonna need your help, Mike. He said, Joe, whatever you need. I said, okay. I said, the first thing we need to do since we're at the hospital, he wants to be circumcised. I said, Mike, he doesn't like the doctor. He doesn't trust him. He's asked me to do the procedure. I said, I've talked to one surgeon and I've been watching YouTube videos all morning. I think I can do it. I said, but I'm gonna need your help. And Mike goes, geez, Joe. I said, Mike, it's okay. I'll do the cut and I just need you to hold it. He goes, Joe, I don't know nothing about circumcisions. I said, well, let's go back and tell him. So I walked in the room and I said, he says he knows nothing about no circumcision. And he laughed. And it was a good time because that moment he forgot the pain he was in. You know, in the end, Mike focused on experiences he'd had, especially his travels with his wife after his retirement. And he also focused on relationships and lamented the fact that he was not closer to some people and that he did not tell more people how much he appreciated them and how much he loved them. He said, we live life focused on achieving power and wealth, and in the end, it is what we do and who we do it with, which are the important things. He said, Joe, it's all about relationships and experiences. There's a gravestone in a Chattanooga, Tennessee cemetery that has words on it that remind me of Mike. The marker says, I came here without being consulted, and I leave without my consent. That to me is classic Mike Clark. When Mike asked me to speak on his behalf, I said, sure. And without thinking, I said, well, what should I say? Real smart. He just looked at me and said, Joe, he said, start with something nice, follow that up with something nice, and then end with something nice. I said, I can do that. And he just shook his head. He had a way of simplifying things that were complicated. As for me, Mike will live on in the kindness I show others, the assistance that I provide to others. Every time I make someone forget their problems with laughter, I know Mike will be there. Thanks, my friend. I love you and I miss you.
Good afternoon. My name is Christine Koehler. When I could see you all, I recognize many of you as my colleagues. For those of you who I do not know, I'm a criminal defense lawyer in Gwinnett County, where I have practiced law for the last 21 years. I first laid eyes on Michael Clark when I was a baby lawyer, appearing as second chair in my very first murder trial. The first motion right out of the gate was whether or not our client was going to wear a stun belt, a shock belt, throughout the proceedings. And as the judge, Judge Clark, took the bench that morning, lead counsel in that case, Keith Davidson, leaned over to me and said, I'm going to refuse to go forward with this trial if he makes our client wear the stun belt, so I'm probably going to jail. I'm sorry? I said, what? And he said, don't go forward without me. Whatever you do, do not let the judge force you to trial without me. I'm going to admit it. I thought of a few moments of glory at that time, proceeding by myself for the first time ever in a murder trial. I was too scared. I listened as Keith fought back and forth with the assistant district attorney who was handling the case. And he said again, listen, if I go to jail, don't go forward. So I sat at the table listening, but really thinking of what excuse I was going to make to not have to go forward with the trial. Instead, my co-counsel did not go to jail that day. Judge Clark actually said, "Mr. Davidson, you're about to wear that stun belt throughout these proceedings, and we'll see how quickly we get this trial done." So we proceeded. Not a great case for us, but the judge let us know very quickly that he was in charge, he was going to make the decisions in this case, and he was running the show. Years later, I told him about that conversation and how Keith had told me, "Don't go forward without me." And at that time, Mike Clark gave me this advice in retrospect: "You should have stood up and said, 'Ready for trial, Your Honor.'" That would have been a great splash into the Gwinnett legal community. And I knew in that conversation, and many after that, that Mike was one of us, that he was a trial lawyer, even though he wore a black dress, that he was a trial lawyer through and through. He never punished us for taking unpopular cases, for arguing unpopular causes, or for zealously advocating for our side. He truly was one of us. I tried a death penalty case years ago in Gwinnett County. I litigated that case for a little over 5 years, and at one point during the proceedings, during that 5 years, I felt it was necessary to subpoena the entire Superior Court bench. It was. Not Billy Ray, he was new. Some of the judges were not thrilled with the subpoena. Some were fine with it, some were not thrilled with it. So when I saw Judge Clark in the cafeteria at GJAC as I was going to get some lunch, I'll admit it, I braced myself for what I thought was going to be a cool reception. That is not at all what I got. I got Exhibit A, this infectious smile, and a scoff, and a laugh, and, "Christine Koehler, you subpoenaed the entire Superior Court bench." Scoff, laugh, laugh, "Good for you." I said, okay. And then he sat down with me and we started talking, and he started telling me about the Hazel Short case, his death penalty case that he had tried back in the 80s in Gwinnett County. There was no anger about my subpoena. There was no backhanded insults. It was just a long conversation between two death penalty defense lawyers. And as a side note, I spoke to the prosecutor for that case this morning over the telephone, Johnny Moore, who has retired to Florida. And Johnny said to me, "You know, Christine, that was really an unwinnable case for the defense." And I said, "Really? I didn't think she got death." He said, "She didn't, he won. Mike Clark won that case." I said, "Oh, it was that kind of unwinnable case." Mike was one of us. 1 year, and I can't even begin to guess the time frame of this, I got a call from my 23-year-old legal assistant at the time, and she said, "Hey, Judge Michael Clark stopped by to invite you to play on his baseball team." And I thought, "Are you kidding? That is so exciting. That's fantastic." I was a college scholarship softball player, and I welcomed the opportunity to show off my softball talents to other members of the legal community, maybe strut my stuff, show off a little bit. And rumor had it that Michael Clark was quite the baseball player in his day. So I thought it was big doings that he would ask me to be on his baseball team. And I knew she meant softball, but she was 23, so what did she know? So I swung by Judge Clark's chambers the next day and I said to him, "I'm so excited. Thank you for inviting me to participate in this baseball thing." And he said, "Okay, great. I'm glad you're interested." And he started talking about a Hank Aaron score sheet league. And it took me a few minutes, and then I realized I had just agreed to play fantasy baseball on a computer. Talk about out of my league. I really followed Major League Baseball at that time. I don't really follow it now, but at that time I really did. But when we did this live draft and Judge Waller was there, a bunch of other folks I saw today in the audience, when we did this live draft, first of all, it was a lot of pressure. Second of all, those guys knew high school baseball players throughout the country that they knew they should draft now because they're going to be superstars in 3 years. I just wanted to throw a ball to Mike Clark and have him throw it back. But apparently, like I said, I was very much out of my league. Incidentally, that league is still going strong, not with me. I bailed after the first year. But this year, that league was renamed to the Michael Clark Score Sheet League. And those guys have been very active on Facebook. I know many are out of town and could not be here today. They're probably reading up on high school baseball players as I speak. Reminiscing about Mike over the last few weeks with friends who knew him long before I did, we all talked about how incredibly smart he was, what a huge reader he was, and he really knew a lot about a lot of different things. I watch a lot of TV, so I could not relate to many of the things that he was saying he had read in books, but I still found him very fascinating to talk to, and someone speaking reminded me how incredibly difficult it was to watch him when an expert witness would come into his court, especially an expert psychologist, because his background and history, his training, his knowledge in psychology really could go toe-to-toe with those folks. And if he thought they were peddling BS in the slightest bit, he took to them like a trial lawyer. It was painful but very exciting to watch, as long as it was not your expert that you had trooped into court in hopes of keeping your client out of jail. He definitely was one of us. I don't want you all to think that I thought that Mike was perfect. He was not the perfect judge. That judge does not exist. Those group pleas that we did, where he would line up 6 to 8 defendants and swear them all in and go through the plea colloquy all at once. State your name for the record. State your name for the record. State your name for the record. How old are you? How old are you? How old are you? That made me just crazy because you kind of could never get into your groove as a defense lawyer. That drove me nuts. But if that was the trade-off for being on an even playing field as a defense lawyer walking into a court, I will take that all day, every day, 6, 8 defendants, whatever it takes. And it was definitely a trade-off that was worth it. I had the pleasure of seeing Mike a couple of weeks ago and getting to tell him goodbye. And I will tell you what I told him because I think it's the most truthful thing that I've said up here. And that is, you were a great judge, Mike. You were quite simply the best. That it shouldn't be, but it's often the case that we are not on even playing field when we walk into a courtroom defending the rights of someone accused of a crime. You were one of us, you are one of us, and we will always love you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Steve Mussman, and I want to first thank Lisa and Mike's family for giving me an opportunity to say a few words about my friend Mike Clark. I come at this at a little different angle. I don't have a legal background. I never practiced law or stood before Judge Clark. I met Mike about 20 years ago when he came to me for scuba diving lessons. I often called him Mikey as a term of endearment. He allowed me this level of poetic license, probably in reference to my age. After all, I was 3 years and 9 days his senior. Ours was an unlikely friendship, but then again, just the fact that it flourished is testament to the genuine nature of what I believe to be his legacy. He was a self-described conservative from Macon, Georgia, and I, an avowed liberal from Boston, Massachusetts. He was already on the bench as a Superior Court judge in Gwinnett County while I was teaching history at a local high school and running a scuba diving business on the side. What I loved about Mike was not his scuba diving skills. Everybody knew that he relied heavily on his designated dive buddy, Gigi, for survival. It was Mike's intellectual curiosity, his integrity, his sense of fairness, and his soon-to-be-tested strength of character that stood out the most. What better foundation could there be upon which to build the ideal judicial temperament? We found common ground in discussing book reviews, often breaching many of the taboo subjects deemed too controversial by the laws governing polite social interaction. We found ourselves engaged in lengthy discussions on religion and politics. We didn't agree all the time, but we listened. When we found ourselves becoming less attentive, we could always shift to sports, where contention is considered perhaps a bit less of a threat. But no matter what the subject, no matter how heated the discourse, there was never, ever, even a hint of animosity between us. In fact, Mike would often gift me books that supported my position rather than attempt to change my perspective with materials supporting his side. Perhaps that was just his way of saying, try again, you need a stronger argument. Then came Mike's illness. I remember my first reaction when he suddenly and unexpectedly sent me a text message containing his diagnosis. I can't repeat exactly what I said, but I loudly proclaimed my objection by permanently affixing a highly objectionable expletive as if it were a prefix to the word cancer. He knew what he was up against from the get-go, but met the challenge with honor, dignity, and courage. Curiously, we would sit around and candidly discuss the end game, and I would invariably leave the scene cursing in frustration in my inability to shift the paradigm. I encouraged Mike to write a farewell speech, hoping he would take the opportunity to address all the wrongs he had witnessed over the years, to finally tell it like it is. But he had another path in mind. This is truly his legacy. When I asked him what message would be to those he left behind, he didn't hesitate to respond. This is the message he wanted to impart on all the friends and family who reached out to him as he was nearing the end. So many kind words were exchanged. So many held their relationship with Mike in high regard. So listen carefully.
What Mike wanted you to consider was a basic tenet of his being. It was his creed. Love thy neighbor as thyself. There you have it, plain and simple. Treat everyone as you would want to be treated. There is no place for bigotry. If we valued Mike's life as we say we did, we should all consider taking steps to make these ideals something more than empty words. Mike, thank you. I'll always be proud to call you my friend.
When I was asked to speak on Mike's behalf, I started trying to find something that could help me put it in perspective. And I found this. It says, "We cannot judge a biography by its length, nor by the number of the pages in it. We must judge it by the richness of its contents. Sometimes those unfinished are among the most poignant. We cannot judge a song by its duration, nor by the number of its notes. We must judge it by the way it touches and lifts our souls. Sometimes those unfinished are among the most beautiful. And when something has enriched your life, and when its melody lingers on in your heart, is it unfinished or is it endless?" Well, let's start at the beginning. We cannot judge a biography by its length, nor by the number of its pages in it. We must judge it by the richness of its contents. Well, Mike's contents were that he grew up in Macon, Georgia. His father owned a small grocery store. His mother was a housewife, and he had one brother, Tony. Talking to him about Tony, I always got the feeling that the one person who could get under his skin was Tony. Tony was a better golfer, and I know that just ate him up. Mike was very proud of the fact that he was a Macon redneck. And when he was in high school, he played baseball. He was a third baseman and a pitcher. And once he finished high school, at some point, he went to a Cincinnati farm team as a pitcher. And he tried to get into the major leagues until they sat him down one day and explained to him that there were no 5'9 pitchers. So he went on to the University of Georgia and got his degree in psychology and spent a lot of time taking classes in philosophy and theology. After he graduated, at some point, he toyed with the idea of being a priest, which I thought odd since Mike wasn't Catholic. But, apparently that passed. And he went back to the University of Georgia Law School and got his degree in law. Now, some years later, he returned to Georgia and finished his degree in theology. Now, while he was at Georgia, he was also in the ROTC. He never really explained it to me. I got a sense that he had some sort of military obligation to pay for his tuition and then he would serve in the military after that. And this was during the Vietnam War. And apparently, while he was at Georgia, the Vietnam War ended. And Mike was preparing to be a fighter pilot. And when the war ended, they had more fighter pilots than they needed, and they released Mike from his obligation. Now, whenever you ask Mike about when he went to college, he would just say the 70s. He started in 1970, he ended in 1980. Once he passed the bar, he went to Floyd County and clerked under Judge Royal for a year. And then he came to Gwinnett County and served in an assistant DA under Bryant Huff. After about a year, he gave that up. And he was going around visiting different law firms, trying to get a sense of what he wanted to do. And at that time, I was renting space from an attorney by the name of Glenn Garrett. And Mike came by one afternoon, and he stayed for the afternoon. We talked for about 3 or 4 hours. And the following day, he was back again, you know, and we kind of spent the day talking again. And later on, Mike would say, well, I was so impressed how you gave up your time to talk to me. And what he didn't realize, I had no practice. So Mike finally made a decision, was toying about going downtown to practice with this guy named Michael Shepard. And Mike, as he would normally do over the years after a while, was he'd ask me my advice. He never took it, but he always asked. And he asked me about going downtown to work for Michael Shepard. And I told him it was a bad idea. It takes an 8-hour day. It turns it into a 10, 12-hour day. You're going to hate it. And Mike said, oh, okay, I see. And he went to work for Michael Shepard. And Mike was there for 60 days. He was there for 60 days because he had to give 30 days notice. So he came back, he got some space in Norcross, and he asked me to come join him, and then we formed a law firm, Clark, Glassman, and McLaughlin, and then we would drive from Norcross to Lawrenceville, and as we were driving, we'd have to drive by this thing they were building called the Gwinnett Place Mall, and every week they were putting up another red light, and then we realized that this trip wasn't going to get any shorter. So we decided, are we going to be downtown Atlanta lawyers? Were we going to be Gwinnett County lawyers? So we decided to move our practice to Gwinnett County and became Clark and McLaughlin. And shortly thereafter, we became Clark, McLaughlin, and Duttweiler. And then after a while, back to Clark and McLaughlin. And it was then, I think around 92, 93, that Mike decided that he was going to run for Superior Court judge. I hated him at that moment. One of the first things I learned when I moved to the county is you didn't run against a sitting judge. And Mike was saying, okay, I'm running. Are you going to support me? And, yep, everything said that I shouldn't. But something in the back of my mind said that you never bet against Mike Clark. And Mike was elected judge and served as a Gwinnett County Superior Court judge for 21 years. And when he retired, he returned to private practice of law until his death. He was a loving father to Katie and husband to Lisa. And I remember when I went to see him in those last days that he asked me if there was anything that I regret, and I really didn't have anything up that I prepared. But he told me that his biggest regret was not loving those he loved enough. But he did. Sometimes those unfinished are among the most poignant. Now, when Mike and I first got together, he didn't realize how bad a lawyer I was. And he went with me one day to a deprivation hearing in front of Judge Morgan over in juvenile court and saw firsthand exactly what he had in a new partner. And it was pretty bad. And I remember we were driving back to the office. I was driving. I don't think we were even driving in the right direction. And we were dead silent. And then Mike finally chimes in and says, well, at least we know you're not a natural. So then, rather than, you know, kicking me out, Mike decided to teach me how to be a lawyer. And he was very kind and generous in that way. He was always willing to give advice. He took me around, introduced me to all the judges, got me on the court-appointed list, and got me into court, got me trying cases. One of the things that impressed me about Mike is that he'd have an attorney on the other side, and it looked like the attorney might miss a deadline or something, and he would call that attorney and tell him, you need to get this pleading in. You don't want to miss this deadline. Mike never wanted to win at the expense of another attorney. At one point, I tried to get Mike involved in my interest, theater. And I had been asked to direct a production of Inherit the Wind. And in this, there are two attorneys, Brady and Drummond. And I had in my mind that I had, you know, John Doran playing Brady and Mike Clark playing Drummond, and I thought that would just be spectacular. And so we had auditions and that sort of thing, and Mike read for the part of Drummond, and he was purely awful. But I wanted Mike in this show, so I said, well, Mike's a judge. I'll make him the judge. How hard could it be? Pretty hard for Mike. At one point, I turned him over to the assistant director, a young girl by the name of Sophie Gatens, and Sophie took him off for about 2 hours and worked on him to get him to give a passable performance as a judge. But Mike, he listened, he learned, he was able to do a passable job as the judge. He got so good that the actor that played the foreman of the jury was a cartoonist. And so every night he was supposed to hand a piece of paper with the verdict to the bailiff, and the bailiff would hand it to Mike. Mike opens it up and reads the verdict. Well, this guy was doing obscene cartoons. And so, you know, and that was the thing. And I knew this was happening. So it would come to Mike, and Mike would sit it on the desk. He would pat it. He would brace himself to open it and then continue to go on. And to his credit, he never broke his character. He stayed in character in light of this very obscene cartoon. One of the things that I'm going to miss about Mike were his sayings. And I still use them to this day, and things that I will use probably for the rest of my life. When it came to trying a case, Mike said there was no such thing as a nice trial. When the ship's going down, all guns are fired. When it came to negotiation, say no till your tongue bleeds. And one of my favorites was, it's better to be thought a fool than to open your mouth and remove any doubt. I tried to stay quiet a lot during those days. One of my other favorites was, you can't make chicken salad out of chicken manure. We used other words, but, you know, for the house, we'll go with that. But so many times I saw him do that. Take a case that had impossible facts and turn it into a win. He had that ability. And when Mike tried a case, he never wrote anything down. And he never organized a file. He handed me a file one time. It was 3 inches of paper stuffed in a manila envelope. So, you know, he had this mind that was so quick that he could try a case and never write anything down. The thing about Mike, though, he was always looking for the next opportunity. He was never satisfied with where he was. He'd get somewhere, he'd start looking for the next opportunity. At different times, he talked about running for governor, running for the Court of Appeals, running for the Supreme Court. One of the people that he idolized was George T. Smith, the only politician, whatever, to have contested elections in all three branches of the government. That's who he aspired to be. And it got to the point, whenever I'd come into the office on Monday morning after a weekend, the first thing I'd do is go to Mike's office and turn on the lights and see if his furniture was still there. Once he became a judge and stuff, I would call him from time to time asking for help on cases and that sort of thing, and we'd tell war stories from the old days. And then, of course, he recruited me to play in the Hank Aaron League. And I stayed with it for a few years until I'd finally had enough. But when I went to see Mike there towards the end, Mike was so proud and told me many, many times how they had renamed the Hank Aaron League the Mike Clark League. And I've been asked to take over Mike's team in the league this year. And I plan to do that, along with my son, Ryan. in honor of Mike, because this was one of the things that meant so much to him. All of these things I carry with me. So the answer to the question, is it unfinished or is it endless? It is endless. I'll always have these things in my heart. How lucky I am to have something that makes saying goodbye so hard. Thank you.
I first met Mike Clark about 5 years ago when we did an evaluation at the ranch for him and Lisa and their dog Ginger when they wanted me to start boarding her. And the first time we met, I knew we were going to hit it off great. We all walked around the field together. We were laughing and joking. We already had a mutual friend in the lady that they rescued Ginger from. And it was just one of those instant friendships that just blossomed. The next time I met Mike, he brought Brady, when they just adopted Brady, on his own. And the evaluation that we were supposed to do that was going to take about half an hour ended up taking about 2.5 hours. And in that time, we talked about everything under the sun. And honestly, that's when I learned so much about him, about the fact that he was going to be a Jesuit priest. But more in particular, which really struck a chord with me, was his views on animal welfare. And he said to me then that one of his greatest sorrows as a judge was that he could not take every single animal abuser and throw them away in jail and let them rot there for a very long time. His words, not mine. And it was just, that was a wonderful thing for me to hear. I've been involved in rescue for a very long time, and to hear somebody in such a position to say that was just music to my ears. When we started out Frankie and Andy's place, our senior dog rescue, they were the very first people, Mike and Lisa, to say, count us in. We want some of this. How can we help? And as soon as we opened our doors, they were there the very first day. In fact, Lisa was there moving earth and helping us to make paths and things like that before the cabin was even open. Mike and Lisa volunteered an awful lot, were there to love on the dogs, to walk the dogs, and him and Boris and him and Donald would often be found trudging around the woodlands up there. It was absolutely beautiful. It was just a lovely thing to see. They would come and sit with the dogs, talk to them, and you could really see that this guy just had such an affinity for these dogs, but particularly the Donald, as he called him. The dog's name was Donald, but obviously Mike had to call him the Donald. So those two really had a great affinity for each other, and Mike would sit on the chair at the back of the cabin with the Donald beside him, and just petting him for hours and hours. And it was really just heartwarming, absolutely heartwarming. Earlier on this year, we started Off the Chain. And Off the Chain is a charity that we've started where we go and take dogs that are chained up or tethered and have no hope of any freedom in their life. And we build fences for them. Myself and six other women started this charity, and we started it on a wing and a prayer, hoping that it would do well and we'd be able to save as many dogs as possible. Well, Mike and Lisa were great, great, great supporters, and back in the summer, I had written about this a little while ago, back in the summer, there they were in 95 degrees of heat. Honestly, everybody was sweating their balls off, and there's Mike there trailing around with a big shovel, saying, come on then, let's get these posts in. Fantastic. That's the kind of way that I will remember him, to be honest, more than anything else, was that particular day, because it was so hot. It was absolutely sweaty and disgusting. And Mike was uncomfortable that day. He was really uncomfortable. He had a pain in just around here, and he couldn't really work out what it was. And of course, shortly after that, that's when he went to the doctors and got his diagnosis. Well, before I move on to other stories, I do want to tell you that the Off the Chain gang, some of you are here today, and we just want to thank Mike and Lisa, but obviously Mike, this shout out is going to you. for the help that you've given us and the support that you've given us. And Mike, the next build that we do is going to be dedicated to you, my friend. That one will have your name all over it. And the next dog that we save off the chain will be in your honor. When Mike went into hospice care a few weeks ago, I started to go over and visit, and it was actually quite wonderful for me. And I know that's going to sound strange, but it was really quite wonderful for me to be able to spend this time with no interruptions, really, really getting to know a different side of Mike. And obviously Lisa too, but with Mike, I saw something completely different in him. The thing that struck me more than anything was that here he was in such great pain, but still a true, true Southern gentleman. I mean, a true Southern gentleman, right down to his very core. There he was. It was quite funny, actually. One night I went in and I saw him with his hands down the front of his shorts. And everybody was saying to him, "What are you doing, Mike?" And he went, "I'm just playing with my pecker." And it just made me really giggle to see this superior court judge talking like that. But even that was said in quite the gentlemanly aristocratic way, and it absolutely made me just crack up. There's many, many people there today that knew Mike in a completely different way to me. I have to say that one of the greatest moments that I saw over the last few weeks of his life was the love of his friend Joe, and it touched me to my absolute core to see that man support and love his friend in the way that he did. Mike was blessed to have the love of his wife, Lisa, and Lisa took care of him. And so was an absolute saint. There's no other way to put it. She was an absolute saint and continues to be so. But to watch Joe sitting by his friend's bedside, just holding his hand and being with him in those final days when Mike really wasn't always compos mentis the whole time, it was really a wonderful thing to see that throughout his entire life, he had made some great friendships and had the love of a good woman and had a really close friend who was with him to the end. I think that's an absolutely amazing thing. And my father had said to me years ago that if you make it through life with one great friend, then you've really scored a victory. You've scored a goal. And I have to say that Mike did. He was a man who inspired leadership in other people. Everybody kind of wanted to step up to the plate with Mike. Everybody wanted to entertain him. We were all a little infatuated with this big presence and this huge education that he had, that he was happy to share with everybody. He was an incredible scholar and always had an amazing story to entertain people. I have to say, though, that one of the most incredible moments that I had with Mike was when me and my husband, Peter, came over to see him just after he went into hospice care. And we were sitting in the living room and having a conversation. And Mike looked off to the side and went, "Yeah, okay." And then started to talk to Pete and I again. And I knew that he was talking to somebody else in the room. And I asked him the next day, quite plainly, if he was seeing somebody. And I said, "Mike, have they come for you?" And he said to me, "Penny, 9 months ago, I started to see my dad and my mum. They started to visit me," he said. "And it was at that point that after I got my diagnosis, that I knew that I wasn't going to make it. But I felt kind of comfortable. And as the time's gone on, I felt more comfortable with it because I knew that they'd be waiting for me," he said. "And I see them often. They're there all the time." Now, he said this to me not in a moment of morphine-addled madness or whatever. This was Mike. This was very straight. This was Mike at his most normal. And I have to say, it made me so happy to think that they're waiting for him on the other side and that he knew it. He was an absolutely great man, a really great man. He was funny. He was bombastic at times. He was just an intuitive friend and a really kind, loving man with a wicked sense of humor and a massive grin. You couldn't be around Mike and not want to giggle, and also not be just overawed by him, by his personality. He's going to be so sorely missed. And I just want to say to you, my friend, go with God, and know that we're going to take care of Lisa, all of us, but go with God and know that, you made a difference while you were here. And we were all very, very, very impressed.
Shadows are falling and I'm running out of breath. Keep me in your heart for a while. If I leave you, it doesn't mean I love you any less. Keep me in your heart for a while. When you get up in the morning and you see that crazy sun, keep me in your heart for a while. There's a train leaving nightly call when all is said and done. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la- Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Keep me in your heart for a while.
When I'm alone, I sit here Lisa asked me to speak at the end because she thought I'd be the one to be able to hold it together. But after that, not so sure. I actually made notes. I haven't written an opening or a closing or questions for a case in 30 plus years probably, but for some reason, I thought I'd better write something down this time. I've known Michael Clark for over 30 years, but we weren't really friends for most of that time. I'm pretty sure that way back when we didn't much like each other. I was a young prosecutor when I met him, back in 85, 86, I guess. Brand new ADA, and he was a criminal defense attorney. I met him on some very forgettable case where he represented I don't know who, charged with I don't know what. But I do remember an unforgettable case that Christine mentioned, and that was Hazel Short. I was very green, sitting there watching Johnny Moore and I think Danny Porter, a young Daniel J. Porter, RDA, who I still think is one of the best attorneys I've ever seen try a case, prosecuting a woman who looked like evil incarnate with facts that were horrific. And somehow he saved her from the electric chair. I don't know how he did it, but Mike owned a courtroom. In time, I learned that criminal defense attorneys were not scum of the earth, as I had been encouraged to believe early in my career. And over the years, Mike and I did become friends, and really not close friends until, I think, after I left the bench, having learned that he was a big cheerleader for me when some people that I believe were close friends weren't there for me. But Mike was. I'm probably one of the only people, if not the only person, that ever tried cases against Mike, before Mike, and alongside him. I actually associated Mike on a case I had in Newton County, a divorce, going to trial. And I asked him to be there with me, not because I couldn't try the case, but because I was pretty darn sure I was gonna get locked up before we were done. And I wanted to make sure somebody could take over and maybe get me out of jail. The case didn't go quite as I wanted from the get-go. I made an argument to the judge that the husband hadn't produced his business records that we had requested. Opposing counsel, who happened to be a law clerk in that circuit before, said, well, judge, discovery expired a long time ago. He was about the fourth lawyer in the case. And the judge politely turned to me and said, well, what's your response, Ms. Miller? And I said, well, Your Honor, counsel's correct. Under the Civil Practice Act, the time for discovery has expired, but I've also given them a notice to produce, and under the evidence code, they're required to bring these records to court. And I brilliantly cited the code sections that I was relying on. Judge's response, you're gonna tell me the law? Started yelling at me. Turned around, looked to Mike, I'm like, get the bail money ready. And he just chuckled. Then the judge, who by the way is the worst judge I've ever appeared in front of, turned to my co-counsel, one of the best judges I'd ever appeared in front of, and said, you've been a judge for a long time, can you talk to her please? I turned to Mike, thinking he's gonna stand up and say, Your Honor, I believe she's correct. No, Michael says, I'll talk to her judge, and in my mind's eye I could see him patting me on the head. Later on he told me I was right. The judge was wrong. The judge was out of line. Again, chuckling the entire time. I don't know, maybe he just wanted to make sure we didn't both end up in jail that day. We all have so many stories to tell about Mike, but our time here today is short, so I'm not gonna talk about others. Although, ask me sometime about the chicken gizzard trial in front of him. That was a memorable one, and it's a great one to hear. Besides the practice of law, I had the pleasure of scuba diving with Mike many times. And I think it's before Gigi started being his dive buddy, I was tasked with keeping an eye on him on his very first night dive in Cozumel. We jumped off the boat in the darkness with our little flashlights and hit the worst current I have ever been in. It was like, there he goes, off to Cuba. I hunkered down in the sand and literally people were flying by and I thought, oh crap, I've lost Mike. We surfaced, we survived. I'm not sure he ever went on another night dive with me, but we did have many wonderful, wonderful dives, mostly with Steve right there leading the pack and Gigi covering his butt. Lisa has asked that I read something that, on her behalf, and I'm going to do that now. She said she wanted me to do it because she thought she might be a blubbering mess. Thank you for letting me be here. And before I read your words, thank you for sharing him, you and Katie, and everybody in the family. Thank you for sharing Michael with us all these years, especially those last couple of weeks. I treasure those the hours, the days I got to hang out with him when he knew the end was near. Lisa has written, Mike always wished he would make an impact, change lives for the better, and leave a legacy. He has indeed left his mark on Gwinnett County and the court system. I hope he is smiling down today to see all the people gathered here in his name. I miss him terribly. Words cannot express the sorrow and silence that now fills our home. Hopefully in time, the grief will lessen. On behalf of me, my children, and my family, Katie and her family, Mike's brother Tony and his family, thank you for joining us today in celebrating Mike's life. Excuse me. Thank you, Lisa. I have the honor of unveiling the official portrait of the Honorable Michael C. Clark, the one that's actually going to hang at the Justice Center, to honor the man who served Gwinnett County as a Superior Court judge for over 21 years. And this picture was particularly dear to Mike because the photographer was dear to him, his beautiful daughter, Katie.
Now, that's a pretty one, but this is the one Katie took, and this is the one we're hanging, because it's gorgeous. Let's keep the memory of Michael C. Clark alive by continuing to reminisce. Let's keep telling all these war stories, because there are so many of them. And most importantly, continuing to live our lives and practice law the way that Mike wanted us to. Remembering each of us has a job. Each of us has a role in making the system work, and we really are colleagues. There's going to be another case, another day. And the next time, your enemy may well be your friend sitting at the table with you. Play by the rules and keep your sense of humor. I was thinking as I was putting words to paper that it's kind of funny. Mike and I would go round and round debating for hours. And then I was thinking, well, I get the last word this time, big guy. But then I realized I really don't. Those of you that have had any contact with Mike the last couple of weeks will recognize some of these words. They come from him, not me. Hashtag. Do it now. It's later than you think. And to you too, Michael, you will always be in our hearts. On behalf of Lisa and Katie and the rest of the family, thank you so much for being here today. Please be safe going home. And as Mike said every time, right before he hung up the phone, I swear every time we talked, you be good now. Thank you.
Stop crying, it will be all right. Just take my